Very good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
You can hear, sir. Come in.
Oh. Hmm. Yes, very good afternoon. As usual, technology glitches. Yes, I have checked. I hope the sound has come back. As you know, we have shifted from morning to afternoon, and I hope by now you've got used to it. And many people have told me actually that they find this post-lunch session much more convenient than in the morning. The morning, something or the other is happening. So I hope most of you feel convenient. As you also know, that the advantage of being live with you all is that we can have a dialogue. I try as far as possible to respond to the questions that come in the second half. But at the same time, if for any reason this 2 o'clock timing doesn't suit you, then you know that it remains on Facebook. All you have to do is to log into Banjara Academy's Facebook page, and you can watch it in the evening, next day, next week, next month also. So this is the advantage of having this program in the afternoons. Now, there are two things that I'd like to start off. One is, how many of you actually received ongoing sex education when you were children? Not just some one-off, session in the school or something like that, but, some mothers would make their daughter sit down when she's coming of age and tell her about how menstruation will happen to you and this and that. That's all that we have been doing. Other than that, hardly any one of the adults of today will say that, yes, I was fortunate enough that I received ongoing sex education, age appropriate, so that as I grew up and as I had doubts and questions in my mind, I was given that support by my elders, be it parents or be it, teachers or whoever it is. One of the reasons why this happens and why we shy away from it is because when I say sex education, people are, mistaking it for sexual activity, sexual intercourse and all these things. The right word actually to use is sexuality education, but because it's a tongue twister, I'm taking the easy way out by talking about it as sex education. Let us understand very basically that when I refer to sex education, I'm referring to sexuality education. Now, sexuality education or curiosity or knowledge starts much before the child becomes a sexual being, much before adolescence. So you have to take into account the fact that children, the moment they start growing up, the moment they start communicating and understanding, they have curiosity which is sex related, or rather, let me put it this way, gender related. In fact, we spoke to many of our colleagues, friends, counseling students and all that, asking them this basic question: when do you think sex education should start with children? As I expected, most of them said teenage, when they come to adolescence, etc. That is actually too late. We should start sexuality education before a child becomes a sexual being, in the sense before his or her hormones are activated and before the child, comes to puberty. And that is what, I need to understand. Why, I'll tell you. Children have curiosity. Children will ask you questions about anything and everything. A child will say to the mother, why is it that you wear sari and that other lady is wearing a Western dress? Now, it's a natural curiosity. Why is it that we eat only vegetarian food and my friends eat non-vegetarian food? Why is it that we have to drive only on the left side of the road? Innumerable such things happen, and children have that curiosity. The first thing I'd like to tell you, even before I go into the specifics of sexuality education, is that never kill the curiosity of a child. Never tell a child, shut up. Don't ask stupid questions. That is not how teachers also do sometimes, no? That is outside the portion. It is not in the syllabus. Don't ask questions which are not concerned with this particular chapter. Now, life doesn't have a syllabus and chapters. Life is unlimited. So you need to understand that children who are curious, children who keep asking questions are the ones who will do better in life. The children who are subdued, who are quiet, who have doubts, but they are scared to even voice their doubts and questions, those are the children who are going to suffer in life. So even in general, I'd like to emphasize on the fact that as far as possible, answer the questions of the child, and more so the questions that start with why. Why is it that this is happening? Why is it that we go on a scooter and my friend's father goes in a car? Why is it that we have this thing? Why is it that that park closes in the evening and they don't allow me after dinner to come to the park? As far as possible, please encourage your child, regardless of the age, encourage your child to ask questions. And equally important, be truthful in giving the answers. If you don't know the answer, say, I don't know. If you know the answer vaguely or little bit, say, this is what I think the answer is, but I'm not very sure. I think we should explore further. Involve the child in that exploration. Yes, I'm also not very sure. So let us find out, together, let us explore and see. In today's world of Google, ChatGPT and all these things, it is very necessary that the child should develop the habit of exploring and finding out through the correct sources. Anything which you do not answer, the child will start looking on the internet. And as you know, on the internet, there are millions of sites. Some of them are very authentic and some of them are good. Many of them are not authentic. They give false information. So if you are open to a child and keep answering his questions, including saying, I don't know, we'll find out. And in the worst case, if the child is asking a question which is not age appropriate, be it regarding sexuality, be it regarding anything else, if a child asks a question which you think is not age appropriate, he or she is too small for you to discuss on this issue. Please tell the child, that's a good question that you have asked. Don't say, no, this is stupid. Why are you asking such thing? Keep quiet. This you won't understand. Don't say that. Say, very good. I'm happy that you have that curiosity. I'm happy that you are questioning this thing. And I would like to give you the answer. But sometimes when you're growing up, it takes time to come up to that level. Explain to the child. When you're very small, I got you a tricycle because you were not able to balance a bicycle, no? So I got you a tricycle. And how happy you were as a toddler, you used to go roaming around in that thing in the house. Then when you grew up a little bit, you got a bicycle because now you are capable of balancing. When you were 2 years and 3 years old, if I had got you a bicycle, you would have probably hurt yourself. You would have fallen down. So that is why you had to wait till you are older. Now you have a bicycle. Now we go out and you look around and see people are going on motorcycles. So you will say, why can't I have a motorcycle? So I have to explain to you that you have not yet come to that particular age. When you grow up, you will have a motorcycle. I will encourage you to have it. If I can afford it, I'll buy it for you, or you will earn money and buy it for yourself. But you will have to wait till then. Also, there is a rule made by the government in your interest that you will get a license for a motorcycle only when you are 18 years old. And when you get that license, then and then only you can ride a motorcycle. Similarly, you can give any number of explanations. You can say things like, now that you are small, we are teaching you arithmetic. As you grow up, we will teach you algebra. we'll teach you geometry. Once you understand geometry, we are going to teach you trigonometry. Now, supposing I start teaching you trigonometry right now, won't you get thoroughly confused and bored? So we have to go step by step. First, you learn arithmetic. Then you learn algebra. Then you learn geometry. And then you learn trigonometry. So your whole learning process is correct. So this question that you are asking me right now is not, you know, suitable to your age. I may be knowing the answer. I may be able to answer you. But I don't think that, you know, at this stage, it is appropriate for us to discuss this. Be a little patient and I will take you forward. I will explain to you as you grow up. And this is particularly needed when it comes to sexuality education. Okay. So, to an answer to this question, when should sex education start? I would like to tell you, it is never too early to start. The moment the child gets up and can walk around, the moment the child learns enough vocabulary to communicate with you, ask you questions, talk to you, that is the time to start giving sex education. And the best way to start sex education is to have a very open communication with your child. Make the child talk and question wherever there is doubts. If the child feels that I can talk to this auntie, this teacher, this mama, this papa, and they won't get angry with me, they won't suppress me, they won't say, gee, dirty, why are you talking like that? The child will definitely ask you questions, whatever the questions may be. There is a girl who sees her little brother without his clothes and she says, what is this between his legs? Why is it I don't have it? Now, as I told you, the worst thing that you can do is, gee, dirty, don't talk like that. Why are you looking that side? Don't look that side. That's the worst thing that you can do to a child. That is the beginning of your sexuality education. You have to start off by responding. You have to start off by encouraging the child to ask questions like that. Say, I'm so happy that you have this curiosity, that you want to learn, you want to grow, you want to get all these things done. I'm very happy. And then, like I told you, then where it is appropriate, you explain to the child. Give whatever little explanation. Sometimes the children are happy with a little bit of explanation and then you say, I will give you more details and I'll, you know, help you to understand better when you are a little older. So little bit of explanation, whatever you can and whenever you can. At the same time, one very, very important thing in today's world is, please remember that unlike even up to the last generation, children have the internet and the Google and the chat GPT now to be able to explore answers elsewhere. Earlier, children would ask their parents or elders, they would ask their teachers, they would ask their seniors in school or in the locality, and if they don't get information from there, they would accept it, that this information is not available, I can't help it, I have to live without it. Today, the moment the child has a curiosity and is not getting answers, the child will start looking for answers on the internet. The type of wrong exposure that the child can get into is very, very possible. And that will happen only if you have, you know, created a scenario where the child feels hesitant to ask you questions. So any form of sexuality education at any age should start ideally by the child asking a question and you explaining. If the child is not asking questions, you ask questions to the child. You may ask something as simple as, do you know how children are born? Do you know what is the difference between girls and boys? And that can be done at a very, very simple level. I still remember, you know, Purni is also here. We had gone to a school to, you know, help boys and girls with some basic sexuality education, 6th standard, 7th standard children. And of course, we had separated out the boys and girls. It was so funny. We asked the boys, you know, what's the difference between boys and girls? So they started saying things like girls have long hair, boys have short hair. One of them said, girls wear small slippers and sandals, boys wear boots. See what their concept of understanding the difference between boys and girls is. And yet, you know why we were called to that school? Because there was a lot of hush-hush going on. This is my boyfriend, this is my girlfriend. Now, they don't understand head or tail of what a boyfriend, girlfriend. But they have this curiosity which takes them deeper and deeper into the thing. But if there is something, and we ask them, do you have a boyfriend or do you have a girlfriend? Do you want to have a boyfriend or do you have to have a girlfriend? Now, for example, we told the boys, there are so many girls in your class. Some of them at least are your friends. Yes, they are our friends. So whom would you say is your girlfriend? Some of them straight away said, no, I don't have a, this thing. They are all my friends. I have boys who are friends. I have girls who are friends. I remember one small child, you know, when an aunt of his, he was talking about some girl and he was talking great praise. She's so good. She's so nice. She's this, she's that and all that. He was praising that girl in his class. So the auntie very wisely, you know, supposedly asked him, oh, she's your girlfriend, isn't it? He said, no, auntie, she is not my girlfriend. She's my friend girl. Small fellow. See how they sometimes seem to be understanding better than us. So what we need to do in sexuality education is, number one, as I told you, encourage them to ask questions. If they don't ask questions, you ask questions about what they know. Either they will say, no, I don't know anything, or they will already know something about it, so you don't have to repeat it, or they may know something which is wrong. And that is how the sex education starts, by correcting the wrong inputs and the wrong information which the children have. Moving on further with small children, you can teach them things like good touch and bad touch. Children develop that instinct. But they should have that open thing to come back and tell, yes, you know, that uncle was touching me and I felt icky, I didn't feel nice. That is when you can give the understanding. Tell the child who can touch you and who cannot touch you. And if somebody who is not supposed to touch you, if that person touches you, come back and tell us. Tell the child that nobody has a right to remove your clothes other than, and then specify, Amma, Appa, Ajji, 1, 2, 3, whatever. Other than that, under no circumstances, anybody has a right to remove your clothes or ask you to remove your clothes. You don't have to go into details of sexuality if it's a small child, but the thing sinks in. And the lifeline is there. If somebody still does it, come back and tell me, I'll take care of it. I will explain to you how to go about it. This goes a long way in protecting children from any form of abuse. Then let us go further on this thing. As I told you, there will be curiosity question. There was a very interesting anecdote. There was this baby, a small girl, who asked her mother, mommy, how was I born? So mommy didn't want to start off on sex education, so she used that old excuse, you know, they say that storks bring children, that white huge bird called a stork puts a baby in a cloth bag, holds that cloth bag in its beak, and it brings. So the stork brings babies is what they say. So mommy took advantage of that. You know, one stork came with you as a small baby, delivered to our house. Now you are growing up in our house and you have become our daughter. So the child asked, mommy, then how were you born? Mommy says, you know, 35 years back, a stork came to grandma's house, delivered that baby, and that baby grew up, and now it is me, Amma. Acha. Ma, then how was grandma born? About 65 years back, one stork came to great-grandma's house and delivered that baby, and that baby grew up and became my mama and became your grandma. Okay, are you satisfied now? Yes, ma'am, if you say so, I'm satisfied. But does it mean that there has been no sexual activity in our family for the last three generations? Now, this is what you have to be prepared for. Children know a lot. And it's nothing wrong in knowing more. Only thing is, they should know what is right and wrong. And they should know what are the consequences of certain acts. Okay, now this happened with this mother. The mother was scandalized that this child already knows that children are born out of sexual activity. So she went and told a friend of hers who had an even smaller child who had not even started going to school. Now that small one said, "Mummy, mummy, where do children come from?" Ah, she wants to know. I have to give her sex education. So she pulled out one big picture book of sex education, made her sit on her lap and started explaining how conception takes place, how a baby is born and all that. That child heard everything. "But mummy, where do children come from?" "I just explained to you." "Okay, let me go more in detail and explain how children are born, what happens, what is conception, what is this, what is pregnancy," all that she explained. Third time the child says, "Mummy, you're not understanding my question." She caught hold of mummy's hand, pulled her to the window. There was a school nearby. And every afternoon when the school gets over, dozens and dozens of children would go under her window. So she wanted to know, "Mummy, where do these children come from?" See the difference? Either way it can happen. But if you have open communication, you can ask, "Where do children come from? What do you think, where do children come from?" Then she would have said, "I don't know. Every afternoon I see so many children coming. They are all wearing blue dress." Now you know what the question is and you know how to take it further. Okay. Having understood that, as I said, sex education should start at the earliest when the child is 2 years, 3 years, 5 years. And it should be a continuous process. It should be an ongoing process. As the child grows up, start explaining one by one. And never ever close that communication channel. A 13-year-old girl asked her mother, "Mummy, does kissing make a girl pregnant?" You know what the mummy said? "What? What is this kissing business? Who kissed you? What are you asking?" That was the end of sex education. That child will never come to mummy with any such questions. Now it's perfectly okay. Firstly, you can say, "No, kissing does not make a girl pregnant. Let it cool off. Talk about something else, girls grow up, after school you go to college and whatever it is. And then ask the child, "Why did you get the doubt?" If by chance some boy has been pressurizing her and saying that, "I want to kiss you," or something like that, then you can tell the girl, "No, you have to be careful. Though kissing does not make you pregnant, but it is not good at your age. You should not be getting into it. You know, once you grow up and you have a life partner, then you will really enjoy kissing. Or right now also, see, I can give you a nice peck on your cheek or on your forehead. That's also called kissing. But that is done by people who love you, like mommy, daddy, all these people. The other type of romantic kissing happens when you have a person for you have a life partner, you get married, whatever happens to you. These are some of the ways in which you have to deal with the children. Always make sex education into a lively thing, light-hearted. Never take it too seriously. Never get into something as though it's a very, very serious issue. Be very lighthearted about it. The same way as if the child was asking about some neutral topic, how you would be, responding to the child, you respond it in that, thing. The other thing which is very important, as a child is growing up in the house, mommy and daddy, whoever are the married couples in the family should not hesitate to express platonic love to each other. So many parents are very hesitant to express any form of love to each other. Now this child grows up with a very funny, you know, doubt in her mind that mommy and daddy don't show any love and affection. They don't hold hands, they don't give a hug. But when mommy's friend comes, she pulls her by the hand, she gives her a tight hug and she makes her sit down, she sits close to her. But she never sits close to daddy when we are sitting in the hall. She always maintains a distance. The other day, mommy's brother came from abroad and how excited she was. And she went running to him and she gave him a hug and he lifted her up, you know, and they had such a wonderful time. Why can't mommy and daddy do it? Now, this is a very, very important factor. Children grow up thinking that it is okay to express any form of love, affection, attention, except when you are married to each other. It gives out a very wrong message. These are small things which contribute towards sex education. And I would even extend this sex education to talk about, you know, life skills education. All these things, once you understand, then make the child comfortable enough to talk to you about anything, any doubt. Sometimes a child may come and tell you, I don't like that uncle. Don't say he's your dad's elder brother or he's your grandfather or he is this. Why do you say you don't like him? You should not talk like that. The child will clam up. If you say, oh, you don't like him, is it? Tell me what happened. What is it about him you don't like? Yeah, a few things about him I also don't like, but other things I like. So I want to know from you now that you are a big child, you know, I think you can help me. Tell me what is it that he does or says which you don't like. Child may even make a very general statement like, I don't want to go to weddings. Earlier she used to enjoy going to weddings and parties. Now she says, I don't want to go. Don't scold and don't say, then what? You can't stay alone at home. You have to come with us. Use it as a means to, you know, have an alarm or a caution. Maybe something happened last time when we went to a wedding. Maybe something is putting her off. These are the things that we need to teach. And finally, let me tell you one very important thing. We talk so much about young men doing all sorts of horrible things. There are minors who are going about, you know, raping their girlfriends and other girls and all these things. See, it's very difficult to teach a sexuality to boys who have already become boisterous and who are already thinking of sex as a conquest and all that. But you can do a lot of work with boys before they become adolescents. I keep telling my students and other people, even, you know, young girls, college girls, I keep telling them whenever I address them, if you have a younger brother, if you have a cousin, if you have a boy in the neighborhood who's 6 years, 8 years, 10 years old, teach them to respect girls. Teach them that girls and boys are equal. Teach them that you can have, you know, a very nice, pleasant and respectable relationship with a girl. Teach them that you don't have to look at a girl with lust and this and that. When they are very small, they will understand and they will grow up into this. So today I have not touched upon sexuality education for adolescents and further ahead. That's a different topic altogether. But as you know, the topic was, when should sex education start? And I've tried to cover that. So I'll take a minute's break. Purni is here with you. After that, I'll be back to answer your questions and your doubts.
Good afternoon. Hope you all are fed up with some nice khana, or those who eat early, have you already started having your hot cup of chai? Yeah, good. So good to know that. And I have some nice information. I thought I'll just share that with you. Some of you all do come down to the academy, and some of you all don't get the opportunity to come to the academy. So I thought I'll just share a few happenings that's happening at Banjara. So Ali usually never blows his trumpet, no? So we thought we'll blow the trumpet on his behalf. So what has happened is, we have this Medical Pastoral Association. It's called MPA, okay? So they are, it's in Bangalore, and they are India's first non-government organization in mental health. So it's like a halfway home, and they are doing tremendous amount of yeoman work in that area. And they are going to be celebrating their valediction of their golden jubilee. So it gives us immense pleasure to announce to you that they are going to felicitate Ali for his dedicated work in the field of mental health on the occasion of their golden jubilee. Okay, so I thought that's a fantastic news, right? And Ali himself has been in this for nearly more than 40 years, doing a lot of work. So Medical Pastoral Association is going to felicitate him. And we had the opportunity of addressing a very reputed company, corporate. And the amount of tremendous response that we received, you know, in the participation in the webinar. Once there were around 700 odd participants. The next time there were around 1,000 odd participants. And the best part of this whole thing was that, yes, it was a webinar. We quite prefer the face-to-face thing, no? But nonetheless, I think one of the striking features was that the amount of participation and questions which came in from that webinar was tremendous, you know, and so much of interaction happened. Ali could demystify a lot of their questions, and that was a fabulous session we had just a couple of days back. And yesterday, we had a webinar addressed by Ali, which was on careers in clinical psychology. You must be aware, right, by now that we do so much of career counseling, which is free at the academy. So we do have people who are also 50 years and plus, who want to have a second innings and a better one this time. So they come down, they discuss. So we, our team guides them into that. So one of the areas which was coming up very rampantly and needed address was clinical psychology. So Ali had a webinar, and it was received very well. We this is from our studio. This happens, right? All this video and our going live and our webinars happens from our studio. So we also had a couple of our students who were sitting here. They told, no, we don't want to go live. We want to be in the studio with you all. And they were with us yesterday. So that was another thing which happened. And very soon, another area which is, you know, you can say in demand, and also that therapy is being used, is the cognitive behavioral therapy, in short known as CBT. So many of them, you know, counselors and psychologists are using this therapy with many counselees and people. So we are going to come out with a comprehensive program so that more help can reach out through the world of counseling to different people. Yeah, thanks, Sheila. Congrats, yes, to Ali, of course. And so I just thought that, you know, usually we give you some announcements. I thought I'll give you some happenings which are, you know, which have taken place at the academy. And so this keeps us busy through the day, doing different things, meeting people online, offline, and our day goes on. So good to see you at this point of time after your lunch, and maybe with a hot cup of chai to keep you awake through the day, right? So over to Ali and for answers to so many questions which are coming up in your mind.
Yes, here I am. Anis does a very good job of, you know, sorting out all the questions that keep coming in the chat box and putting them up one by one so that systematically I can respond to each of them. The first one is from Asha. Bringing sexual education in the ambit of school curriculum is very important. Is working at the grassroots level the key to operate? Yes, it is, Asha. It is very necessary. And I do hope more and more schools take it up. I come across some schools who say that parents are not very happy. They don't want us to talk about sex and sexuality because they have this fear that children, if they are told about sex, they will start indulging in sexual activity, which is absolutely wrong. If they are explained in the proper manner, there's a lot that can be taught at the school level. But unfortunately, as I said, for various reasons, not many schools are doing it. I do hope they increase. But as concerned adults, it is our job to keep doing it. And even if schools do it, they may do it as a one-day or half-day program. And that's the end of it. In 1 year, half a day with so many children sitting together, it doesn't really, you know, cover the whole gamut of their curiosity or their understanding. So that is the reason why parents, concerned adults, counselors, teachers, whoever is dealing with children should take up this responsibility of doing it, including if you are interacting with small children. And when you're interacting, of course, with teenagers, then the need gets much more. And it has to be done on a regular basis. Now, here is something very interesting. I told you that children have a curious mind. Children, anything you talk to a child, and the child's mind starts working at full speed. And the child starts responding, reacting, questioning. But over a period of time, unfortunately, what we do is we keep suppressing the child. We keep telling the child, this is a stupid question. This is outside syllabus. Don't ask these things. This is not the appropriate thing. How can you do this and that? We don't realize the impact on the child. We think that, you know, we are guiding the child by not allowing the child to get into unwanted areas. But that is not true. It was never true. And now in this era of, you know, digital economy, digital thinking, and these children being digital natives, it is all the more so. So we need to be sure that they ask. And here is a classic example that when I am talking about so many other issues and topics which are directly relevant to adults like you, immediately your mind is stimulated and you keep on asking. Have you noticed in the last few sessions, there's a stream of questions that keep coming. This time, when I'm talking about a very essential topic, a topic which is directly connected to life skills, to the well-being and to the development of children, I'm not getting much questions from you people. That means that this does not carry that impact. This does not have that much of, you know, attention or seriousness from your side. And that, I think, is a very fundamental mistake. We make this mistake and we pay the price for it when that child grows up. Okay, thanks to Sheila, we have another question here. Yes, appropriate communication should happen at schools. It is best imparted at school and also received well by children. Yes, in the school, the advantage is that it's a little bit of a non-threatening environment. The child doesn't have to be at his best. the child may be scared that if I ask daddy or mommy any questions on this, they may get angry and then they may doubt me and then they may scold me. The same way as I told you about the child asking mommy, does kissing make a girl pregnant? But in schools, there's a non-threatening environment and there is a group and you can get into the anonymity of that group. Whenever I do sexuality education in schools, what I do is I give every child present over there a slip of paper and I say, write whatever doubts, questions that you have with regard to the topic that we are discussing today and don't write your name. I don't want to know who wrote what. You feel comfortable that nobody knows who asked. I collect all those slips and I start answering them. In fact, in some of the colleges, one of my students had become the principal of a college and she used to invite me. We used to do a full day workshop on life skills. In that, what I used to do was, in the morning, we put them at ease by talking about life skills. How to build relationships, how to manage your emotions, how to control your anger, how to set goals in life, all that we would be doing. Just before we break for lunch, what we would do is give these slips of paper to the children and say, post lunch, we are going to have a discussion on sexuality. Whatever questions you have, whatever doubts you have, write it down and give it to us. We would collect that. It used to be huge numbers. We used to collect all those slips. And sitting down at lunch, we used to start sorting them out. I would bifurcate them into those which have some sort of a medical touch to it and all the others. I have a good friend who's a practicing gynecologist. I would invite her to come for half an hour, 1 hour post lunch. And as soon as she comes, I would bifurcate and give her all the questions. For example, you know, what do you do if you have this type of menstruation? What do I do about this? You know, if I feel a pain in my vagina, what do I do? This was a girls' college, so they were comfortable that they were all girls. So all those, you know, questions which used to come, I am already, you know, older than my classmates, but I have not come to puberty. All my other friends have got. What happens, you know, if somebody has got small breasts or big breasts and why does it happen? All these questions. Now, she being a gynecologist and she's used to the human body and all issues related to gynecology, she would go ahead and answer questions. And that used to ease off the, you know, seriousness of the situation. And she would realize that here is somebody who is answering so openly and so frankly, using all possible words about anatomy and about sexuality and all that. They would be at ease. Then I would take up the non-medical part of the thing and start answering their questions. My boyfriend wants to kiss me. Should I allow him to kiss me or not? My parents say, don't talk to boys, you will get into trouble. But they don't tell me what trouble. What trouble will happen if I talk to boys? See the innocence of these questions. And then we would do it. So if more and more institutions are open to it, we are very happy about it. Okay. Now here is a notation from Roshan. Open communication with your child can go a long way in helping clearing most of their doubts. My granddaughter, who is 13 years age, asked me one day, how many boyfriends I have? I said, countless. So she asked me back one special boyfriend. So I said, yes, I do have. And what do you do with him? See the child's question. What do you do with your boyfriend? So I told her that we have a platonic relationship. Again, she wanted to know the meaning of platonic. So I explained that we have a mutual understanding and respect for each other. She was, you know, scared that I may get angry or I may get upset, but it doesn't happen. See, this type of question, the child having open communication with her grandmother, not even her mother, shows that that child can benefit so much from the interaction with adults, isn't it? So whether you are a grandmother, a mother, an aunt, a neighbor, a teacher, a counselor, whatever you are, you must encourage the children to ask these type of questions. How many children you know, have the courage to even ask their mother, mommy, do you have a boyfriend? It is so nice if the mommy can explain that, yes, I have a boyfriend. I'm very attached to my boyfriend. Who is that? It is your daddy. I love him very much. I have loved him since so many years. That builds the foundation. No, but other than daddy, do you have boyfriends? Yes, I have boyfriends. I have friends who are boys. I have this friend who has been with me from school days. And every now and then we catch up. He lives in a different city, so we don't get much opportunity. But whenever possible, we catch up. And you know, there's so many nice things to interact, to communicate, to laugh and joke, because we know each other since we were 5 years old. So this gives the child an understanding about gender relationships, right? Yes, Vinita says, yes, correct, Ali, totally agreed. We are still not very comfortable talking about sex because it's how we have been brought up. True. If at all we asked any question to our parents, we were just asked to keep quiet. Though if my children had asked me, I would answer them, but still the uneasiness in there, how do we overcome this? This is one of the reasons why I had selected this topic of when should sex education start. Okay, now if you have a child whom you are interacting with and the child has already come to teenage and the child is asking questions, or you need to talk to him or her about these issues which are directly connected to sex, you definitely feel very uncomfortable. But if there's a 2-year-old, 5-year-old, 8-year-old with whom you're continuously talking about sexuality, then you're very comfortable. As that child grows into adolescence and teenage, your discussion goes smoothly. You're already on very good terms with her. And remember one very important thing. Whenever I talk about sex and sexuality, I start with the concept of family. I make the child understand that wherever you go, whatever you do, your refuge, your OSS, your place of comfort is your home and family. Isn't it? They all agree. Now, how does a family come to exist? It happens when a man and woman get married. Only marriage is the beginning and the foundation of a family. When they are married, children come out of that marriage and that becomes family. So I explain about marriage. Then I talk about commitment. See, if mommy and daddy remain committed to each other till the children are grown up, they're always there. They'll have fights, they'll have differences, but they're still committed to each other. I explain about commitment. Then I go on to love. Mommy also loves you, daddy also loves you. But the way they love each other is a different form of love. So I explain about romantic and erotic love. And then move on to sex, depending on the age of the child. How much you can talk to the child about sex. Right, Shireen says, even today, women do not want to see a male gynecologist for their problems. Yes, Shireen herself is a doctor, so she knows that very well. But it's very interesting, Shireen would be knowing better than me, that only in India, we have overwhelmingly large number of women as gynecologists. In the Western countries, there are more male gynecologists than female gynecologists. So you see the difference. Anything to do with any professional activity, why is it that we are so scared or so hesitant about it? That is because of the way sexuality education was given to us. When a girl was very small and she's just lying down with her frock going up or her, you know, panties visible, the elders would come and say, chi, look at the way you're lying down. How can you sit like that? You're a bad girl. Now imagine that same girl 20 years later has grown up and is married and has some gynec issues. Will she be open to consulting a male gynecologist even if he's very reputed and very good? The basic instinct would be that, no, I can't allow a man to see me. These are the effects of wrong sexuality education, right? Okay, Asha says, there is a movie called Trapped, which throws light on the importance of sex education and how it affects adults. It answers basic questions like, what are we expecting in our lives? Did we invest our time in life skills? Or were we thinking only of good job, big house and all these type of things? Excellent, Asha. I would also like to see that movie. But whenever such a movie or such an input comes, we do benefit a lot by it. But it's not always available, no? So we have to take some time, effort to ensure that this goes on. And it should start with the whole family. The family should be open to discussing all these things. A child will see in some, you know, TV or movie or somewhere that this girl was not married and she became pregnant. Now this girl is very curious. I always thought that a man and woman marry and then only children are born. If these topics are discussed, that yes, ideally speaking, a man and woman should marry and then produce children. That's the way of nature. That's the way of religion. That's the way of society. But you know what? Sometimes girls do indulge in unwanted activity before marriage. And that can make a girl pregnant. And then she has to face so much of difficulties, no? So if that girl says, no, I will indulge in sexual activity only after I get married and with my spouse. She's so comfortable, she's so relaxed. That same pregnancy can be a day of rejoicing rather than a day of horror because I have become pregnant. So slowly these things should be taught to children from as early age as possible, right? Roshan says, my father-in-law, 90-year-old, was so broad-minded that he would discuss this subject freely. Exactly. And that is probably the legacy that she left with you, Roshan, that, you know, you have that type of communication with your granddaughter that she can even ask you questions like, do you have a boyfriend and those things. Sridevi says, sadly, Swamiji's are more trusted than doctors. And she adds on, I mean, fake Swamiji's. Yes. In all professions, all walks of life, there are good people and bad people. Once in a while, you may even come across an incident of a male doctor taking advantage of a female patient. You may come across a teacher who molests students. You may come across a driver working for a family and they're taking care of him and treating him like a family member, but he starts molesting a child. But these are very few and far between. Because of that, we should not allow our minds to get, you know, put off and corrupted and all these things. Ravali says, hello Ali, when a teenager starts developing sexual feelings, how to deal with him or her? My first answer is, deal with him or her before she starts developing sexual feelings. That is the ideal thing to do. And that is the reason why I took up this topic, that when should sex education start? Prepare the child much before. Don't we do it if your child is going to go to college, the child has come to the end of the schooling. You start explaining that you may have to live in a hostel. This is the way it is going to be. This is how you should take care of yourself. You don't wait till the child gets admission in a college, goes there, and then teach him, you know, how to deal with college life or hostel life. The same thing comes over here. Okay. By chance, if you have not, done so, and now you realize that this child has come to puberty, this child's hormones have been activated, and this child will have sexual feelings, have an open communication and explain that there is a difference between feelings and actions. Explain in as simple terms as possible. You have gone out, you're feeling very hungry. It's still going to be a half an hour or 1 hour till you reach home. You don't have money. Do you steal the tiffin of your classmate or do you grab something from a shop, some food which is kept over there and try to eat it? You don't know. Why? Because you have dignity, you have self-respect, you have your own sense of morals and values. Sometimes you have to suffer because you're so hungry. It will take 1 hour before you reach home. Maybe you have a glass of water. Maybe you do something, whatever else. But you say, I will wait home, go back, and in a dignified manner eat food which has been made for me. Look at, you know, sexual feeling that way. It's normal and natural to have feelings, but it is not normal to indulge in premarital sex. And that is where your discipline comes in, and all this discipline and this and that will help you eventually when you grow up to take the right decisions, not to get unnecessarily influenced by others, and to keep your head held high and not have any regret or feel ashamed about whatever you have done, and to be able to move on into a beautiful life where you will have your profession, your job, your earnings, your respect, dignity. You will have a life partner who is committed to you rest of your life. You can build very good communication and understanding with your partner. All these things can be done. So keeping these basic things in mind, as I told you, as far as possible, start with small children, work with them. If you cannot do it directly, if you know people who have children who are small, but the parents are not doing it, at least whatever we have discussed today, tell them that you may have a child who's all of 3 years or 6 years or 9 years, but this is the way you have to start off with sexuality education. And then when the child grows up, you'll be very comfortable dealing with adolescent issues. So taking that into account, let me wind up the session for today. As you know, we will be meeting next Saturday again at 2 o'clock. And the topic is reinventing yourself. What do I mean by that? Willing to risk trying out something new. Are you complacent in life, and are you saying, yes, this is my profession, this is my role in life, this is what I'm doing, and I am happy, I will keep doing that for the rest of my life? Sometimes it doesn't happen. Sometimes you have to take a risk of trying out something new or changing yourself, doing something different. And that is why I gave it this title, Reinventing Yourself. So give it a thought. Have your own questions and comments ready so that you can also contribute to the discussion and give me some very nice tips so that I can also use them as part of the discussion during that time. But do join us, please, on Saturday, 19th August at 2 o'clock, and tell any of your friends who are interested in these basic topics of human behavior, relationships, to please join us. As you know, it's a free thing, open to everybody. You just have to log on to Facebook, go on to Banjara Academy's Facebook page, and there you are. So I am looking forward. I'll see you. Topic called Reinventing Yourself. Bye-bye.